you this morning a word that will touch our hearts, touch our minds, lead us deeper in our walk with you through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Sometimes in our lives we go through a series of blows, troubles, heartaches, and like him, our hearts are wounded. And gradually, if we do not find healing for those wounded things that happen to us, our heart gradually hardens. One of the three who had gone up on the mountain, seen the transfiguration. three and many other situations that Jesus favored Peter. He was the one that Jesus said, get out of the boat and come see me. He didn't ask any of the other apostles to do that. And yet Peter, when confronted by a woman, when Jesus had been arrested, said, I don't know the man. Denied knowing Jesus. Three times. I do not know him. Sometimes I think many of us have experienced a similar kind of betrayal in our lives. People that we loved turning their backs on us or hurting us in some way. But notice what Jesus did after the resurrection when he comes to meet with Peter. He didn't say this. He didn't say, well, you stab me in the back. Take a hike. These other 10, they hung with me. They didn't deny me like you did. No, that's not what Jesus did. He did ask Peter a question, though. Do you love me? Peter said, you know I love you. Feed my sheep. He asked him three times, do you love me? And the third time, by the third time, Peter's probably getting a little frustrated. Didn't you hear me the first two times? Yes, I love you. Feed my sheep. Peter denied him three times. Jesus questioned him three times and restored him to the fellowship of the company. He loved him enough that he was forgiven for his betrayal. Now, the third thing, can't leave this one out, is the cross. Jesus going to the cross for you and for me, for our sin. We mentioned this earlier in Sunday school. Why did he go to the cross? 1 Corinthians says he went to the cross for our sins. You see, the things that we do wrong also damage our hearts. When we sin against God or against other people, damages our hearts as well as the hearts of others. Yet Jesus was willing to die on the cross so that we could have new life. It's through the blood of Jesus Christ that we are renewed and made whole. Doctors and scholars and scientists have said that blood is what gives us life, and that without it we can't live, obviously. Of course, you can't live without a brain either. That's a whole other sermon. But blood gives us life. And the blood of Christ gave us another kind of life. Jesus loved us so much, he was willing to die for us. And it's not because we're worth anything in particular. But let me tell you a story I told you before, maybe you remember it, maybe you didn't hear it, but it's one of my favorite stories. Rick Warren was preaching to 5,000 inmates at a prison, and he could tell they didn't really have their attention. Maybe a few of the guys right in the front were with him because they were the Christians in the group and they wanted to hear him, but the rest of them, they were all, just whatever. I'm glad about myself. This is better than that, but not much. So he pulls out a $50 bill out of his wallet, holds it up. How many of you want this $50 bill? How many hands do you think went up? 5,000 hands went up. Then he takes the bill, he crumples it up, he tears it a little bit. How many of you want it now? 5,000 hands went up. Then he spit on it, and he throws it on the ground and stomps on it and squishes it around in the dirt, the mud, and picks it up and he says, how many of you want it now? Said this to him. Even though that $50 bill has been crushed, torn, stomped on, muddy, it still has value worth $50. And even though your lives have been crushed and stomped on and dirty and muddy, in the eyes of God, your life still has value. The same as it was before. He still loves you just as much. that's true of all of us. Regardless of what we've done, regardless of what has happened to us, He loves us. You see, the love of Christ never fades with time. It never dims because of disappointment. It will always shine brightly into our lives if we will let it. I want to end with one of my favorite passages in Scripture from the book of Romans. Many of you know it. Chapter 8, starting at verse 31. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Separate you from the love of Christ. Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you, Father, for the gift of your Son. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love poured out for us on the cross. So, Father, as we partake of your body and blood this day, Lord Jesus, I pray that you would help us leave this place, knowing beyond a shadow.